and sisters.
Woo!
Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning, brothers and sisters.
Woo!
Well, it's an honor to stand before you today. This has been a great convention so far, and this section of the convention, I think, is really fitting to follow Governor Brown and Secretary Treasurer Shuler as we begin a discussion about women leaders in Oregon's labor movement. Over the last year and a half, women labor leaders in this state have gotten together to address concerns. Concerns that women are not getting the equal seat at the table, either in attendance or the way that we are treated. The group initially began by sharing our experiences, the barriers and sexism that we faced in the course of our work. It was also clear that for many years, many of us just brushed it off or buried it, trying to convince ourselves that the work that we do to build Oregon's labor movement was worth it, and more important. Convinced there was a better way, and because it starts with us, we formed the Oregon Women Labor Leaders, or OWL for short, to help address and solve the issues we are facing as women so that all of us could perform our work more effectively. Out of this work, our group expanded, and more women wanted to be a part. More and more women wanted to have a say. Out of these meetings, we came up with a list of commitments that each of us could do to lift up women and help address the concerns and barriers all women in this movement face. The commitments are about supporting each other. They're about recognizing our work, interrupting sexist behaviors, and providing opportunities for women to shine. We are asking women and men and other allies to sign on to these commitments. You will be hearing more about the commitments later on during this convention. I would like to thank the women that helped us get OWL off the ground. If you are present and attended an OWL meeting, can you please stand up? I know some of you are here.
Everest Morrow, OSCA, AFT 6732, and I read this one with pride. After organizing my first rally in my organizing job, an elected leader of a large union came up to me and confirmed it was my first rally, and then proceeded to say, "I guess we could say we popped your organizing cherry then, huh?"
Yeah. spoke during a meeting with a specific leader, he would say, "That's actually a good idea." He never says this when men speak.
Mike three.
I'm Courtney Ebel with the Central Oregon Labor Chapter and ONA. After a coworker had parked the forklift in a ditch, I was asked to hop on the forks and unload a truck in the yard. I spent the rest of the day on the forklift without an accident. We got paid extra for running the forklift on this site. I hopped off at the end of the day and went to the porta potty to find a drawing of myself on the wall, including boobs and bigger groin area, on forks with an arrow pointed to me that said, "She wants to be a man." Oh. It took a week to get the porta potty removed.
Okay, we're not going to move it. Who knows? I short things out, so forgive me if this thing just dies. Patrick Tenson, Lane County Labor Chapter President, and ASME retiree, and proud to be retired, ASME, and North and National Writers Union. My program director asked me to put together a report, a plan to present to our board. I did. It was honest and set realistic goals. He didn't review it prior to presentation, but was the first to call me on the carpet for blindsiding and undermining him. The following year, he presented my exact report and plan at an international convention and received a standing ovation.
I'm Adrian House, president of Oakland HP. I was going to visit a member at his office. I introduced myself and he proceeded to look me up and down without even pretending he wasn't doing so. He was so exaggerated it wasn't even funny. I was lucky I was on my game that day and I didn't let it faze me. But had it been another day, instead of laughing it off with my colleagues, I'd been crying.
Sarah Ryan, Oregon Labor Candidate School. We were on an organizing drive, and we had to carpool back to town during a storm. I asked if I could drive in the middle, because I was worried about the drive. One staff organizer said to me, and someone else, "Sure, you can be in the middle, just like a Mexican sandwich. You know you like that." The other staffer then repeated it.
Tina Turner, Morgan Local 2376, Oregon ASME, and the president of Coalition Black Trade Unions. I was the only woman on an all-male team during an organizing campaign. The lead would consistently talk about women's roles in the House, presumably at best as a way to connect with my other colleagues. It was always assumed that my roles were to be the note taker, the poster designer, and the party planner.
Mike four.
Rosetta Lynn, 2C Business Representative, IETSC Local 28. A union president brought me into her office and told me to stop wearing fuck me pumps and push-up bras and that I had a bad reputation.
Jennifer Parrish Taylor, political organizer for AFT Oregon. I worked for a union and my boss was recognizing my good work and wanted to move me into a higher paying position. She flagged my name for her boss and he said, "I'll move her into that position, but she's not planning on getting pregnant, right?" I did not apply.
Mike three.
Hi, my name is Janelle James from AFT Oregon. As a staffer, an elected affiliate leader, after hearing I was pregnant, said, "Oh, I could have told you were pregnant just by looking at your boobs." This was said in front of all the staff and some members.
Thank you. Can you join me in thanking these volunteers for sharing?
share these testimonials with you because it's important that we all understand that these things are happening within our union and that it needs to stop. We also need to recognize that race, sexual orientation, and other identifiers often make these experiences even worse. Not only is it wrong in that it hurts our movement, but it is no way to treat anyone. Every woman in this room has been impacted by similar stories. And we will work with women and men and allies to break down these barriers, look for opportunities to lift up and support women in leadership roles in Oregon's labor movement. It won't be perfect, and it won't be easy, but we need to address these issues now. We will be a much stronger force when we have a table that includes all of us. Responsibility is ours. Now we're going to hear a panel discussion where some affiliates have taken this responsibility head on. I would like to introduce the panel moderator, Yana Carroll. Yana joined the fight in 1995 with her work at the Evergreen State College Labor Center that led her to apply to the AFL-CIO Organizing Institute's apprenticeship program. After nearly a decade of representing workers within local unions across this country, she joined the American Federation of Teachers National Staff. We give a prop for that. As a Portland resident, Yana considers herself extremely lucky to have the opportunity to assist in strengthening our labor movement in her home state for the past 10 years. Yana?
Collaboration. conversations, we recognized that, you know, there needs to be something done here, that there had been some level of conversation in the past with other leadership, you know, that had maybe made micro progress towards this end, but, you know, that we need to do something a lot greater than what had been being done. So we've engaged many, creating an opportunity for them to have a safe place to come and talk. And then it's about listening, right? Listening and asking the right questions, developing a group to identify problems and solutions. And so that's kind of how we've gotten started there. Even recently, through those conversations, a lot of those ladies have you know, come through the apprenticeship, and so we're not only identifying things that are going on job sites, you know, in our industry, but to even just get into the apprenticeship program. So even recently, a lady came and applied, single parent, you know, had, you know, those things that we all have, you know, payment of bills and insurance and rent and putting food on the table. And our apprenticeship program is structured as such that there's 2 weeks of some basic training, and it mostly surrounds safety, which is very important on job sites, but it's unpaid, right? It's an unpaid 2 weeks. And there was no way this young woman could, you know, live through those 2 weeks with, you know, her financial situation. So we started doing everything we could to scramble and come up with resources within the local to help her out, but it really wasn't quite enough. And so I went out and reached out to our contractors, and we ended up having one of our contractors sponsor this young lady and cover all that was needed, and that's growing. We have more and more contractors asking to sponsor the So we have a lot of work to do in this area, and we're staying after it. It's got to be consistent, right? You can't say, well, you know, we're going to take a month off, or, you know, it's good enough for now, or something like that. It's got to be.
And I came to the labor movement rather recently. My history is actually in community organizing around LGBTQ justice, racial justice, and reproductive justice, and looking at this intersectional lens. And if it wasn't, I've always worked in collaboration with unions, and also have always been in coalition, but I've never actually had real experience within the labor movement. And if it wasn't for women leaders in the labor movement, like Stacey Chamberlain, taking, like, being a mentor and actually investing in me, I wouldn't have been able to make it to this table, because my resume is fantastic for political and community organizing, but it's not necessarily something that can get you into the door with most labor unions. And so knowing that those skills can be interchangeable is really critical.
Can you talk a little bit more about this term gender justice and why we're taking this issue on an inclusive manner?
Yeah, so when we're looking at gender justice, we have to look at this as it's an opportunity that we're bringing everybody up and giving everybody equity, not just equality, because you can be equitable, but that's what we're here for, but we tend to, as a movement, look at equality as being the same thing, and it's not, when we really talk about true equity. And so when we think about inclusion, what are those barriers? Who doesn't get to come to the table? If we're bargaining, are the barriers that are keeping people from being able to be involved? Also, what are those barriers that keep us from having actual equity? So looking at what are childcare, transportation, healthcare, and then also just job experience, being able to get to the table. And also we're looking at equity. Gender is more inclusive than just men and women, and so we need to really look at this as gender is not a binary, but it's actually a spectrum, and so how are we being really inclusive and building a movement that includes everybody who is a part of it already?
Yeah.
We also changed our membership cards. It used to say sex, and it had a marker for male or female. And that, again, left people out. People may not have known what to select if they didn't identify as one or the other. So we've switched it to gender, and we left it with a line so everyone can just self-identify who they are and how they identify. And so when we add in to our database, we still have to have it coded in a way, but we've added a third marker in our database, and it's on our end, but we put X in there. So you have male, female, and then the X is the non-binary because maybe someone doesn't identify with either side of that. So those are a few things that we've done in the systematic sense to really try to make our union more inclusive. We also need to think about all of the areas in which women in the labor movement to be more included as well. So one big area is the hiring process, which is looking at experience in a different way. Maybe historically the labor movement has been a lot of men. So when you're looking at just labor experience, or maybe how many arbitrations a person has won as a counter, when someone may have never had that as an opportunity to be able to do that, but still has the skill set. So changing the way you're looking at the hiring process, as in what are the skills needed to do the job, not necessarily what are the things that someone has specifically done that meets those technicalities of like arbitrations or grievances. We're also, as a staff, we have started doing meetings where the women on staff get together and are able to work through a lot of this and having different things. I've had male coworkers, one decided to tell me how to do organizing work one time, and it was my first day on the job, and he asked me if I understood sports when describing something to me. And so my response, because I have a sarcastic defense mechanism, was, so you mean the one with the sports ball? But I don't think he thought that was funny. I was just
to work with your coworkers who are allies in this and have them help speak out in those instances and be able to really interrupt that as they see it. Also, working with the men on staff to become better allies and being able to open that up for folks is really critical as well. And another piece that we're doing is actively supporting each other and actively supporting women to be in leadership roles. And so this also comes as when you're working with membership, making sure that we are actively looking for women leaders and investing the time in them and helping them become more. And so, like, in being able to get them to a point where they can come on staff, or taking on leadership roles where they're running for office within, getting into decision-making roles within the office. These are all really critical things that we can be doing. And so as we move forward at Council 75, it's being actively trying. Like, we must do this. We can't just let it happen. We can't be passive about it. So we're gonna move forward. We need to make sure everyone is aware that we're all moving forward together.
Raised in Southern Illinois. She came back to us and began working at Working America in 2010 and hired by the Oregon AFL-CIO in 2011. She currently serves as the Federation's political and legislative director, where she directs field efforts during elections and advocates for Oregon's workers in the Senate legislature. She served as the Federation's field director, where she specialized in bringing together community-based organizations and local unions to work together on issues crucial to Oregon's working people. I'm glad you're here. So, as Federation, you have a much broader picture than most of us in our day-to-day work in our individual unions. Have you seen a shift in the appetite to tackle these issues since the last national election
cycle? I think we've definitely benefited from the national narrative that's changed, right? I think it's hard for folks to deny that working women in this country have a unique and significant set of barriers. When Al first started, it was in January, right after the election, right? Right before President Trump took office. And it started with 15 women in a room. And over the past 9 months, we've had over 150 women show up to an OWL meeting and engage, that, like, physically show up. And I think what's also important to remember is we think about this work and its relationship to the previous election cycle, that 54% of white women voted for President Trump.
Whoa.
A man who, among other things, bragged about sexually assaulting women, stated that Mexicans were rapists. When we talk about this being a gender justice issue, this is clearly an issue that all of us have work to do in. And I think that all this work and all this momentum is reflective of the broader push that you're seeing women stand up and say, you know, I want to be engaged. I want to take action. I want to run for office. And I think it's our challenge as a labor movement and as their unions that represent them to be their first outlet and make sure that the barriers that have been there previously aren't there. And when they step up, the first place that they sure that we're as strong as we are, or as strong as we can be. And the only way to do that is to make sure that all of our membership has an equal say at the table, like Stacy said, and that we're doing everything we can to make sure that everyone in our membership has the tools that they need to beat back all of these concerted attacks.
So what are some of the next steps that Powell has in mind, and how can individuals and affiliates get involved?
Sure. So everyone has the OWL agreement on your table. Stacy talked about it a little bit. I want to talk a little bit about how this agreement came together. So Secretary Treasurer Liz Schuler came out and met with a group of us earlier this year, and we all sat in a room and we said, like, nobody just wants to tell these stories. This is painful, right? As I looked out across the room, I was tearing up as these stories were being told. Some of you were tearing up. There was a lot of shaking heads. We wanted to do something proactive. So we thought, what do we do in the labor movement, right? We build tools for everyone to use. So we built this list of agreements, and it was like a 3-hour conversation with really amazing women in a room, and said, what do we recognize as the things that are problems, and how can we get folks to move forward? So the agreement is a collective document that was made months ago that we're asking folks to sign on to. And everyone can sign on to it, and it just means that we're paying attention to the dynamics in a room, and even though conversations may be uncomfortable, that we need to have them. So I would first ask you to sign the agreement. There are paper copies, and there's also one online that we would be happy to share. The next ALCA meeting is on October 16th, location TBD, but if you're interested, you can see Emily at the front desk, and we'll put you on the list so you can attend. And I think the last thing that I would just say is that everybody needs to be brave in this work, right? We know that these conversations are hard. We know that it's going to mean sharing power in ways that we've not had to share power before. But what I can tell you, and I think what a lot of folks in this room can tell you, is that that work is significantly more or less difficult than living those experiences on a weekly basis. And I just want to reflect for a second. When I first entered the labor movement, I was really young, right? I knew lots of you then. And when one of these instances first happened to me, I went to one of the first women that I met and said, what do I do, right? This can't happen. And I was told, well, sit down. There are two things that you need to do. One, don't encourage that behavior. Two, don't call attention to it, because both of those things hurt the movement. And I will tell you that I do not call attention to this issue because I want to hurt the movement. And I think all of us call attention to this issue because we recognize that only when we tackle this issue will our movement be stronger.
Will you join me in thanking the entire panel for this important work we do? strength is going to be coming from not only this people in this room, but through you, because you have the power to invite, to encourage, to mentor, to make space for those people who we will need to be leading, to be next to us, to bring that flexibility and be able to take on those challenges that are before us. So, does everyone have scratch paper?
No.
Post-it notes or something?
No.
Okay. We'll give you a minute, see if we can find some. And then when I say go, what I would like you to do is to number 1, 2, and 3, and you can do it as many times as you want to.
But I still have that.
But for number 1, if you wouldn't mind writing, what are some of those barriers that you think that women are facing to leadership, to activism, to membership in your union? For number 2, what can you do individually to help address them? And number 3, what ideas do you have for OWL and directions that you think OWL should be taking? So, number 1, what are those barriers? Number 2, what can you do to start taking down some of those barriers? And number 3, what ideas do you have for what the OWL should be up to? And on your way to the committees and lunch, please give them to one of these wonderful